It's just incredible honor to be in front of you guys. I have listened so many of the sessions and I know so much from this for this community that it's really, really an honor to be here. Now, today, a quick question. DBAs in the room? Okay, so the percent DBAs, okay. The other guys, developers? Okay. Now let's see, managers. No one. Perfect. Okay, just one person. Okay, cool. So today what we are going to do today is we're going to talk about a topic that more or less is one of the most complex topics inside SQL Server. At the same time, it's one of the most important ones. It's just so crucial to understand how transactions work, because at the end of the day, transactions are what makes our application work and are responsible for what data our users are seeing. Right? So just one last question before we start this up. How many of you have had, be honest with me, how many of you have had the time to play with all isolation level SQL Server offers? Be honest with me. All of them. Okay, full room. Okay, cool. So what we are going to do today is we are going to play with all of them, like every single one of them. And we are going to see what are the problems, how everything works, what are the problems in one isolation level, what are the problems in the other, where should we choose what. So I believe if you care about what data your users are seeing, and if you care about, let's say, how your applications scale also, then this session will definitely be of great help to you. Now, a first disclaimer, this is not a hackathon talk. So we are not talking about in-memory OTP tables by any means. Why I'm saying that? Because in-memory OTP and the hackathon tables introduced three more new isolation levels with them, right? However, how many of you use hackathon in production? Yeah, that's why we are not talking about them, right? Obvious. It's an obvious thing. Now, a few words for me. I'm coming from a country that's called Bulgaria. I am a SQL Server consultant. I work for a company that's called Bullpros in Bulgaria. I spent 3 years as a senior DBA at HP Enterprise Services, and my customers were some of the Swedish companies as we were discussing this today. I'm also an MVP, which means that I love speaking, traveling, podcasts, webcasts, blogs, what have you. I'm just coming from Oslo, and then I'm going to Paris to also speak there. I do a lot of freelance trainings for companies, events, organizations, and I'm a Pluralsight author. How many of you know Pluralsight? Okay, I have some vouchers for Pluralsight with me, so please be a bit more active today because I really want to give them away. And last but not at least, probably one of the most interesting parts for me is that there is one thing that really makes me sick in this life, and it's broken presentations, and especially broken presentation design. So because I'm so sick of this, I decided recently to found a creative agency, 356 Labs, that is doing presentation design and presentation. In general, it's trying to make people achieve more by presenting like it's 2015, right? Because I'm a bit bored and I'm a bit disappointed by the level of the presentations out there. Now, let's go back to the SQL stuff. How are we doing our session today? We are going to first lay out the fundamentals of concurrency inside SQL Server. Because if we don't do that, we don't have any chance of understanding what's going on in transaction isolation levels. We'll just shortly talk about concurrency, and then immediately we're going to spend our time talking about all of the isolation levels. And this session is very heavily demo intensive. There are at least 15 demos. So we are going to spend more or less our time in demos. And at the end, of course, there is something that's the question and answers, but I definitely like encourage you to just ask questions whenever you have them and don't wait for the end, because as I told you, we have some prizes here. Now, the fundamentals. Yeah, first question. Everything will be available for you, no worries. Don't write any code down, DMVs, etc. You have everything tomorrow, let's say. Now, let's lay out the fundamentals. Let's first talk about concurrency. What is concurrency inside SQL Server? Concurrency in general is how SQL Server works and how SQL Server makes our, and more or less everyone inside the system, access the same object at the same time, right? This is what concurrency stands for. Now, inside SQL Server, we have two types of concurrency, right? Pessimistic and optimistic. The default one is we are in the, but which one? Say it out loud. The pessimistic concurrency control. Yeah. So what do we have there? What do we have there? First thing we have is locks. What are locks? Locks are in-memory objects. They reside in our buffer pool, and they take us from our memory. How much? Around 100 bytes per lock. Not that much, but if you think about it, if you have a lot of them, then it may become interesting. However, what locks are, what's more important about locks are that these are objects that give you information about what's going on inside this system. Are we reading there? Are we writing? Are we about to modify something? This is the information that locks are actually giving us. Now, there is something else that's called locking inside SQL Server. Hello and welcome. So there is something else that's called locking, and this is the mechanism that is using those locks to guarantee to us that we are seeing consistent data. Next, we have blocking, right? We have, we are blocked because someone else locked something. And blocking by itself is one of the most frequently seen concurrent problems. I don't know if you agree, but I see your head shaking already. And blocking by itself, if you think about it, it's not a problem by itself. You always get blocking. The problem with blocking is when it's for too long. Then it becomes really, really interesting what's going on inside the system. Then we have, of course, the so-called, how many, is there a person who doesn't know what deadlock is in this room? Okay, so then we have deadlocks. And this is one of the most famous and most widely seen concurrency problems inside SQL Server. And we have another very interesting problem in pessimistic concurrency that's called lock escalations. How many of you have seen lock escalation in production? Okay, more or less full room. Do you know what the to put it in the context, what lock escalations for everyone? What like lock escalation is, just to remind us for everyone here, what lock escalation is the tipping point. At some point, SQL Server says, if my transaction, if my query is touching more than a number and is grabbing more than a number of locks on one object, do you know how many are they? What's the threshold for lock escalation? What's that? 5,000. You will get a poor side voucher right now. So if we grab more than 5,000 locks on one object from one query, then SQL Server says, that's stupid. I know a better way of handling this situation. Why? Because you're wasting memory. You're wasting resources inside SQL Server, and SQL Server says, I can do it better. What it does is the so-called lock escalation that you can grab with extended events, profiler, many, many tools inside SQL Server. Now, this is more or less the pessimistic world. Now, what do we have in the optimistic one? We have something that's called versions of the data. And we'll see those after a short time in the demos, but this is completely different from the pessimistic concurrency. Those versions are versions of the previously committed data, and those versions are stored in the so-called version store, which is located inside TemDB. So at the moment, at the point in which we choose to switch to some optimistic concurrency isolation level, we immediately have more TemDB activity going on. Immediately. Just immediately. Now, that doesn't change, however, that in optimistic concurrency, we also have locks, no matter what is written on the web, and etc. Why do we have locks? Because the writers, the guys that are modifying the data, are always taking locks, no matter the fact that you're in optimistic concurrency control and you are using some of the optimistic isolation levels. That doesn't really matter. You always grab locks when you are modifying data. And we'll see that. That, of course, causes blocking also inside the optimistic concurrency where everyone thinks, oh, there is no more blocking inside there, right? Not the case. And you will see it after a moment. And so we can face the so-called update conflicts. This is something that you are also going to see inside the demos. So this is more or less the overview of the concurrency control. Now, what are the most frequently seen lock types? We have the shared one. When we are going to read a resource, we have to place a shared lock on it. And this means that we are reading that resource. That resource, however, is being locked until the moment we completed the read, right? By default, this is the behavior. That behavior changes completely when you switch to different isolation level, as you will see. Now, there is another type of lock, which is called exclusive. The exclusive type of lock is when we have to modify a record or modify an object. Now, there is something very interesting for the exclusive lock, and it's that its duration is till the end of the transaction. Why is that? Anyone knows? Why are we holding the exclusive lock until the end of our transactions and not until when we modify, we place exclusive lock, we modify, we release? Why are we keeping that exclusive lock till the end without you, sir? Why are we doing that? What's the problem?
Because the transaction
can be rolled back. On the spot. So imagine the case in which you start a transaction, you modify something, and you release the exclusive lock. Now, in the same time, another transaction starts, modifies what you just modified, and commits. Now, however, your transaction has to roll back. How are you going to roll back something that is not in the state that you left it? Doesn't make sense. It cannot be done. That is why we keep the exclusive lock till the end of the transaction. Now, there is another important type of locks, which is called the update lock. And the update lock is one of the most, at least I believe, so one of the most clever type of locks out there. It's a really interesting mix between the shared and the exclusive. And the update lock is taken when you are about to modify, but you're not ready yet. Now, what does that mean? Imagine that you have five rows that you have to modify. Four of them is absolutely okay for you to update immediately, right? Absolutely okay, no one is reading them, so you can place exclusive lock on them immediately. However, that fifth one is a problematic one because someone else is reading that at the same moment, at this right moment. Now, what's going to happen? If I place exclusive lock and wait for this fifth lock, I'm blocking the readers here, right? Because exclusive and shared, as you'll see on the next slide, they don't like each other. So isn't there a clever way? There is. We place update locks on those records and we say, once we are ready to modify, those locks will immediately be converted to exclusive, but we are waiting for something to happen in order to allow us to modify those records, and once it's okay, we'll convert them. However, in the meantime, those records that we locked are still readable. And you improve the concurrency of your system by doing that. Actually, not you, but SQL Server is doing that for us. And the last more important type of lock or more important type of locks are the so-called intent locks. And those are really important, as you will see after a second, because they give us and they give to the so-called lock manager crucially important information about what's going on inside the system. Now you see the examples. Now, this is a very shortened version of the compatibility matrix, but what I wanted to point out here is that first, the exclusive lock is not a friend with anyone, right? Once you place exclusive lock on something, that's it, more or less. No one else is allowed, and you are getting then that green thing inside Management Studio, you know that? In the right top, in the right bottom corner, that starts to circle. But the update one, you can see that the update one allows shared to be on top of it and to be a friend with it. So it's a really, really important stuff. Now, every single time we start a transaction, we place locks on four levels. Those levels are the ones that you are seeing here. Now, why are we doing this? Let's see an example. Let's say that I love Sweden so much, and we are liking Sweden so much, that we decide to move here. How is that going to look like? Of course, if it's not raining every day. So how is this going to look like inside the system? First, we are going to place a shared lock on the database level. And stay with me, we are going to discuss it after a sec. Then what we are going to do is we are going to place intent exclusive on the table level. What does that mean? Intent exclusive means somewhere down below the hierarchy, I plan to place an exclusive lock. This is what it means. This is the information we are having. Down the hierarchy, we have the page level. And on the page level, we say intent exclusive again. Why? Because somewhere down below in the hierarchy, I plan to place an exclusive lock. And on the fourth level, the row itself, I place exclusive lock. Now, this is how it works. Now, my question to you is, why am I losing resources on those three guys? When I told you that locks are taking us memory, why am I wasting locks and memory in general to place all those locks? What am I allowing myself? And what am I guaranteeing by doing that? Any ideas? Throw out ideas. Any ideas? Come on, guys. Oh, yeah, please.
So that other guys know, depending on what they want to do, so you don't have to find exactly where everybody is.
Of course. So in simple words, do you think it's right for me to modify a table or a record and for you to drop the database while I'm modifying something? Do you think that's, like, okay in terms of behavior? It doesn't work this way. Somewhere we have to know from where and what is going on inside the system. And that's why I told you that locks are giving us information about what's going on inside the system. And the so-called lock manager works with that stuff and knows what's going on, and so it stops incompatible actions. So if I place a shared lock on the database, if I try to put an exclusive lock on the database, which is the one that I need to drop it, is that allowed? No, it's not. You start circling. Or you put outer database rollback immediate, of course, or something like this, right? Outer database. What was the command? Rollback immediate. Anyway, set single user mode with rollback immediate with no wait. So this is why we need this stuff. The same on the table level. If I want to drop the table and I have to place an exclusive lock on it, once I see intent exclusive there, it will say, sorry, someone is working with that table. It doesn't work. You cannot do that. So this is why we are having that hierarchy of locks. And all of that information is present on so many places inside the SQL Server. Now I'm about to show you where you can grab that information. But in general, the problem here is not whether or not we can find that information. The problem is whether or not we want to find it. Right? That's something very, very important. Now let me show you, let's jump to the first and short demo, and let me show you the locking hierarchy that you saw in action and how we can see what locking do we have inside the system. Now, let's hope that everything will be working in terms of the screen, everything else is working. Now, reminding you that all the scripts are going to be there for you. You are going to be able to see them. Everything is there, so don't worry about that. Now let's start here. Let's create a simple database to play with. Isolation levels. And let's create a table. Let's create an empty table. And I just want to simulate a blocking scenario. So I open a transaction and don't commit. Just want to simulate a simple blocking scenario. In another transaction, I'll just copy that and try to select the information, and I'm blocked, right? You have seen that many, many, many times. Now, how can we troubleshoot that? First idea, let me show you some scripts. First idea, I'll copy all of that till the end. So first idea, there is a really nice DMV that's called DMTranLocks, where you can find a ton of information. Now let me show you the locking hierarchy in action. Here it is. Here is the output from this script. And as you will be able to see, take a look at that. We have four locks per session. So What are those locks? Let me see if I can zoom in. But you are seeing them well, so no worries. So these are the first session, and the other four are for the other session. So take a look at it. It's really interesting. So if you see what is happening here, on database level, we have shared lock, right? On object level, and I'll copy that object ID now, on object level, we have intent exclusive, which the object is by itself, guess what? The table name, right? So shared on database level, intent exclusive on table level. Then we have intent exclusive on page level. And at the end, on RID, row identifier, we have exclusive. This is the locking hierarchy in action. The same applies for the other session, right? Absolutely the same. Four levels: database, object, page, row identifier. This is what you saw on the screen, on the slide. Now, how I can see a bit more of this? How can I see, for example, who is doing that? Or which row exactly am I locking here? You can see that there is a column here that's called resource description. And remember that ID. One, what's the word? 2 points, I don't know. What's that?
Column,
okay. Anyway, and 290. Now, there are some other ways you can grab this information. I told that I removed the noise. There are some undocumented functions like the so-called lockres that you can use to find what's going on and which resource is having which resource ID, which row is having which resource ID. And so you can easily now map what's going on. The other way around is that you can see, for example, with this script, I can enhance this and see, okay, let me see on session level which rows are locked and how are they locked, right? What locks are we waiting for those two rows? Some other ways of you capturing this is if you want to see who is the user also that actually did that on both on Windows level, and you can grab it, of course, in terms of login name. So you can grab all of that information from the system views, from dynamic management views, or for some other system objects. Now, there is one more thing. How many of you know SP who is active? I expect the whole room. Okay, more or less every one of you. So if you don't know what SP who is active is, go immediately download that stored procedure. It's written by a genius guy that's called Adam Mechanic. This thing, you have to have it on all of your production servers. No worries of anything. I mean, at least my customers at HP were having it without them knowing it, but that's another case. But this thing is one of the best troubleshooting stored procedures that you can get out there. And it's free. I mean, seriously. So what SP who is active can give you is not just a dump, as like a snapshot of what's going on inside the system right now, in terms of queries, in terms of who is blocked by who, by whom, how many resources do we have, etc., from where, etc. SP who is active is really interesting when you start to add some of its parameters. Then it becomes really powerful. For example, get plans, get additional info, and get logs. Take a look at what's going to be returned. Why is I run that? And we're going to see that in action after a second again. So again, you have the SQL text, so you can see what queries are being run. You can see who. Now, the new stuff is the query plan. So you can see some of the queries and what execution plans they have on one from one central place. Yes, please. And you can see the logs also. Take a look. This is the same information as you saw before. Log request on database level shared. And then these are the levels object, page, RID. The same thing. You just want to, and you have to just choose which one you like most. The information is there. Now, the most important column here is something that I will use later on again. The third parameter that I added, additional info. This column is really interesting. Why? Because it gives you this information right here. what isolation level is this session currently running under? That is crucial. And I'll give you a real-world example why it is crucial, especially in 3 a.m. as we talked, when you the last thing that you would think about is what isolation levels are those sessions actually running under, the ones that they called you about in 3 a.m. Now, these are the ways that we can capture all of that information. And of course, there are many, many others. You can use Profiler, you can use extended events. And I muted that sound. You can use a lot of things. You can just choose whatever works best for you. Now, let's switch. This is more or less everything for concurrency. That's it. That's what I think you have to know in order before we jump to the isolation levels. Now, let's switch gears a bit and let's move to the isolation levels themselves. Now, let's first go to the pessimistic world, because more or less, how many of you are seeing applications that are using optimistic concurrency now? Anyone? Still? No? No? You may be surprised by what I'm going to show you after that. Are you using Azure by any means? Here in Sweden? Yeah? The SQL Azure database? Yeah? You may be surprised by what you're going to see after a moment. Now, let's fire this up with the pessimistic concurrency controls and the isolation levels that are there. Let's start from the ground. Let's start from the worst ever possible. The read uncommitted. Now, what is read uncommitted? You can set it like this with set isolation level read uncommitted. Or how many of you, is there anyone that haven't heard no lock? Yeah. Okay, obviously you all know what no lock is. Now, it's the same. In terms of results, it will return you the same as you were in read uncommitted, as you are going to be in read uncommitted. And I don't have anything in mind against no lock. I just have something against the people who use no lock without understanding the consequences that it can bring you. Now, what is read uncommitted? I start a transaction. I start my transaction and I start modifying something, and because the exclusive lock is held till the end of the transaction, it is what is being drawn here. Now, in the meantime, there is another transaction that kicks in and it tries to read data. What happens is that it is allowed to read that uncommitted data. That's the same with read uncommitted and with no lock. So you are seeing data that is not being committed yet. And probably what I have seen is, imagine this case, for example. Imagine that you are, it's not applicable here in Sweden because you are a modern country, but imagine that you are like in a country like Sweden, modern, and your healthcare, the people are having healthcare apps on their phones, okay? So imagine having a case like this. You have a logic in your application on the customer side, on the customer application, that uses no lock to see what drugs are being transcribed, or whatever the word is, to this guy, to himself. Now, what happens? The doctor goes into the system, enters the drugs that he thinks that are for you, and at that same point of time, before he commits, you are seeing that the drugs that are prescribed for you, right? And you go to the, what's the word for? Okay. You go there and you are about to buy those. However, that doctor obviously missed the fact that there are two or more people with that same name. And these drugs that you saw, because you are reading uncommitted data, are not for you. So, what happens next? I'm leaving you to your imagination. What can happen if you have a case like this? And these are real world stuff. So, my suggestion is, if you are using read uncommitted, because many times people are using read uncommitted or no lock, more or less, because readers are blocking writers and vice versa. Writers are blocking readers, they go with no lock. Why? Because no lock is almost not taking locks, and so it doesn't block that much. If you are using no lock or read uncommitted because of that case, just switch to optimistic concurrency. Just go in optimistic concurrency and try it out. Try to see whether or not your application will not work better this way, or better yet, you can do some a bit more expensive stuff, but it's more or less something that many companies are doing. Offload the readers to another copy of the data. That's at least you are reading committed data. At least that. Please, 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 please understand the importance of this. Now, any questions about the read uncommitted? Or it's more than less clear that we should not be using it that often. Okay, let's move one level higher. The default isolation level, read committed. What do we have in read committed? I place a shared lock on a record, I read that record, I release the lock, and I go to the next one, right? The same applies while I'm reading those records. Now, if another transaction kicks in, that was in Bulgarian, I can easily update some of those records that you just read and commit in the meantime, or I can easily insert a new record that you are about to see after a second, right? Now, the first thing, the update, is the so-called non-repeatable read phenomenon. So we had the dirty read phenomenon, reading inconsistent data, uncommitted data. The second concurrency phenomenon is called non-repeatable read. I'm opening a transaction, and I have three selects in that transaction. And I'm reading the first time, I'm seeing the data. I read the second time, and I'm seeing the data being modified. The data is already not the same. So I don't have a repeatable read. Now, what else can happen? The so-called inserts that can happen are the so-called phantom records, the third concurrency phenomenon that we know out there. What is phantom record? I read the first time, I see 50 records. I read second time in that same transaction, I see 51 records. How is that possible? Phantom record, nothing to stop me. And what else can happen in read committed? Anyone else? Can you think of what else can happen in terms of problems in read committed? There is no concurrency phenomenon, like it's not defined, but what else can happen in read committed? Can you think about something that looks strange? Let's take some water in the meantime. Okay, so what else can happen is I can read the same row twice in the same select, or I can miss a row entirely from my result set. And you'll see that after a moment in the demo. Now, this is the default behavior read committed. Now, whenever we talk, I missed to say that, but it's really important. Whenever we talk about isolation levels, there is one thing that we really have to understand as IT professional, and it hurts me to say that, but it's true. Isolation levels are really easy to be configured, set up, enabled, whatever you like to say it. The important part about isolation levels is that they also have to be a business decision. They are not just our decision, unfortunately. And I'm saying that with all my pain that I can express, right? I always want to control everything as an IT professional. However, isolation levels are not the thing that we have to choose by ourselves. This has to be coordinated with the business. Now, if any of those problems, whenever you present those in front of your business staff, is a problem, the non-repeatable reads or the phantom records, or the things that you are going to see after a second with the missed row, etc., we have to go higher. We don't have any other choices. We have to go higher on the third isolation level, which is called repeatable read. And in repeatable read, we again set it like this on top, as you can see. Now, in repeatable read, what I'm doing is once I start my transaction, I select the first time. What I'm doing is every single time that I'm selecting, I'm not releasing the shared lock anymore. This is why I told you that once you switch the isolation levels, then the behavior of the readers changes. how it changes, I'm not releasing the shared lock anymore. I keep that shared lock until the end of the transaction. How is that helping me? If this guy kicks in again and tries to modify, not possible. Why? Shared and exclusive. It's not possible. So repeatable reads are not, non-repeatable reads are not possible anymore, right? You will always see the same results as you saw them in your first select. However, there is one more thing. Who is going to stop me to insert a record? What is going to stop me to insert a record? Nothing. So the phantom records are still a possibility. They can still happen. And if that is true, and if that is something that you are worried about, then you have just one more option. And it's go higher. And it's going to the highest pessimistic concurrency control that's known to people, to the earth. And it's called serializable. Now, what is serializable? In serializable, once I select the records, not only am I not releasing the shared locks till the end of the transaction, I'm actually doing this thing. I'm locking the whole range of locks. And so I am not just keeping my locks on the records that I read successfully, I'm locking the whole range of values that are part of my result set. Why? Because I don't want anyone to be able to insert a record that can fit my result set if I select again. Right? I cannot allow to first see 10 records and on the second select to see 12. That's not possible in serializable. This is how we prevent the so-called phantom records. Now, these are not possible anymore. Phantom records are not possible. However, bear in mind that this is the highest concurrency control you have in SQL Server. And this means that the blocking that you are going to see inside your system will be massive. Will be massive. So it's a trade-off. It's always a trade-off. Yes, please.
So are you saying that it's not automatically locking the whole table?
No. You will see something very interesting based on your comment right now with serializable. Serializable has one very important problem that many times we are missing to think about. You'll see that in the demo, and it's completely related to what you are saying. We can lock the whole table if we are not careful enough, and you'll see that. And one last thing about serializable. I don't know if you are working with a lot of development teams from all across the world, but there is one class in C# transaction scope that by default, if we don't change anything, defaults to serializable isolation level. So it's very cool to know that, right? It's very, very important stuff. And this goes back to why I was waken up at 3 a.m. to troubleshoot a blocking scenario. And then this thing comes in to play. Now, let's do all of the pessimistic concurrency and go for a break and then continue with the optimistic. Now, let's dive into demos. Okay, guys, are you still awaken, everything is okay, fine, you are focused. Yeah, I'm coming from Bulgaria. If you are not focused now, when are you going to be focused? Okay, let's see. Read uncommitted. Let's start from the beginning. Read uncommitted. A simple example for you. And you can use those examples if you have to present somewhere else. Creating that same table. And then inserting a record without committing it. In the meantime, our healthcare app is being started by someone, by one of our customers, and I select the data before that specifying read uncommitted. So what I'm seeing is inconsistent data. So this record has not been committed yet. But I'm seeing it. This is absolutely the same if I run that same select with no lock, right? No surprises, it works the same way. It's fast. Yes, I know. And there is, I don't know if you have been on this session, but Margarita Numova from Bulgaria also presented here. And Magi, when we talk about this, Magi has a very cool name for no lock. She calls the no lock query hint the turbo button inside SQL Server. And it's more or less true. It's more or less true. The problem is, do we really understand what we are doing with the turbo button? Now, the same applies if you use one of those query hints which specifies in what isolation levels we should be in, on query level. The same thing. It doesn't really matter. So be really, really careful about read uncommitted. Now, the next thing that I want to show you is, I don't know how to stop that sound. I muted everything, but it's still going on. Now, the next thing, a quick example on the no lock, because many people know that no lock is quite fast and it doesn't block. Wait a bit. It's blocking. The no lock can also block. Have you seen an example for this? Yes or no? Some of you have, some of you know. So let's see. Creating the database again. Creating that same table. Then, what I'm going to do, I'm going to insert a record and commit it, because I want to have a record inside. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to start a transaction in which I'm going to alter the table. So by adding another column. So let's say that I open this transaction and obviously ran it. Let's see the locks. What am I locking here? What do we expect? Whoops. What do we expect to see here? We expect to see these guys right here. Schema. SCHS, schema stability. And down there, we have schema modification lock. Why? Because we want to be sure that while we're running our transaction, no one else will be allowed to modify the schema. Now, that is cool. How is that a problem for our query with no lock? Take a look. If I run a query with no lock, guess what happens? Do you remember this guy here down at the bottom that starts to circle? So the no lock is now blocking. Why is it blocking? If we run that same script, you will see that someone else is also waiting for this type of lock, right? And so you cannot, this guy here, oops, we saw today some paintings from Dali, but I'm very, very far away from this guy. So schema stability again. So we are waiting because we also, the no lock query has to grab a schema stability also. So don't think that SQL Server and no lock will never block. It can. It definitely can. Now, let's move on. Enough for no lock and speed and performance. Who cares about performance nowadays? So, yes, I want to quit the query. Now, I will show you something with read committed. Let's see the read committed default behavior. I want to show you something very quickly. No, please. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to open a new session where I'm going to copy that script. This is the same script that I'm using to see the locks, right? And below it, I'll be dumping the content of database pages. The main idea is what? The main idea is to see how read committed works. I'm going to run a huge select, and I'm going to be refreshing the dynamic management view to see what pages and what locks are we having. What am I expecting to see? I'm expecting to see every single time different page to be with shared lock, right? This is why we are saying that in read committed, we are placing a shared lock, we read the record, we release the shared lock. The same again for the other record. And go and on and on and on. So let's see that behavior in action. Let's check whether or not that's true. So if you want to enlarge your adventure works, I believe you have seen that script, but there is a link for you to see it. Now let's run that huge select that can take at least 5 minutes on my virtual machine. And in the meantime, I want to select and see what's being locked. Now take a look at this resource here and remember the name, remember the ID. If I run that same select again, take a look at it changes again and again and again and again. So taking lock, reading, releasing, taking lock, reading, releasing. Now if I go and say, okay, let me see whether or not that's true because I'm not that sure. Where did that copy that? Okay, so if I place this ID here on this spot and I enable to be able to see the output of this command in the console by using the trace flag, I can scroll down easily down there and I can see that some of the data that you are seeing on that page is from that table. So that makes sense, right? I'm seeing different pages being read every single time when I'm refreshing the view, right? Why? Because I play share lock, I read successfully, complete that operation, release. Read again something else, complete, release. That is how SQL Server works in its default behavior. Now, that is very interesting. However, let's see the problems coming from that. And if you can hear my computer, I don't know if you can hear it, but it's starting to really work hard. Now, if you can, what are the problems from this? Let's see. Because we are releasing those locks, what I can do is I can run a query, which is I'll select all of the job candidates with ID higher than one. And because I now read them successfully, there are no locks anymore, right? But the transaction is still opened. So what I can do is, and what can happen, here is the locks. Here are the locks. What can happen, take a look at what locks are we having. Nothing. Some XML stuff because there is an XML column somewhere in the table. But no shared locks anywhere, except for the database level, of course. And so, if there are no locks, who is going to stop me to run something like this? What is going to stop me to update a record in between your transaction? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. And now once I commit, so it's been 11:69, okay? And now once I select again in that same transaction, once I select it, it's different value now, right? In that same transaction, this is the non-repeatable read in action. I'm seeing different values in that same transaction. I'm reading three times, and three times I'm seeing different values for the same data. How is that possible? It is. It is. Absolutely possible. What else? What else can be a problem? Close all but this. I told you that there are a lot of demos. Stay with me. What else is possible in read committed? Who is going to stop me to do the following? If I create again a database, who is going to stop me to do, oh, this is, wait for it, read committed phenomenons. So the phantom record will be later. I want to show you that special phenomenon that I was talking to you about. Now, the fact that you can miss a row and the fact that you can see a row twice in your transaction. Take a look. I'll create a table. Let me see if I created it. I don't think so. Okay, and then I'll insert those values. 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3. As simple as that. Now, what am I going to do? I will do the following. I will update the column B here. So this value will become 12. That's it. And I will not commit anything. Why? I want to place exclusive lock somewhere in between. Now let's update that record. And now in another transaction, in another session, I will select. What happened now? Can you think about what happened just now in terms of results? What are we going to see now? I read the first record successfully and released the shared lock. right? Because the first lock, the first record is not being locked. So I read it successfully. I went to the second one. However, it's being exclusive locked at the moment. So I'm blocked now. And so I cannot move on. Now, in the meantime, however, I can swap the places of the first row and the third row. So I can say, okay, first row, go and become the third one. Because once I remember, the last value was 3. Once I put it on 4, it will become from first to last. And vice versa. The last record will become the first from 3 to 0. So I'm swapping their space places. So let's run that. And if you run that, you are still not seeing anything here, right? And if I commit now, let me just actually, if I commit now and I see what I'm having in my table, this is what I'm seeing after being after the commit. So the last record is now first, the second was updated successfully, and the first record is now last, right? But that's in that session. In that other one, that's not the case. You have the first record read, and the last one is actually the same. However, where is the last one? You don't have it. You just don't have it. And this is completely possible with read committed. However, completely impossible when you're in optimistic concurrency. Why? Because there you just grab a snapshot of the data. However, this is possible, and we have to know, let's say, about that. Now, let's go 2 more, I believe, and let's go for a coffee. Yeah, 3 more. Repeatable read. Let's explore repeatable read. So we have seen read uncommitted. We have seen the problems with read committed and how it works. Now let's see repeatable read. Let's say that I'll run that same query where I'll select the job candidates which are higher than one. And these are the results. Again, nothing special. Here is the record that we just modified. Now, what I want to see is what are the locks which I am holding at the moment. What are we expecting to see here? Okay, no response from you. What are we expecting to see is quite a lot of locks compared to read committed now, right? A bit more. Now, what are those types of locks? Shared locks on keys, on the values themselves, right? I have placed the locks and I'm not releasing them until the end of my transaction. And so, if that's true, if I go in another session and try to update, am I allowed to? How am I going to be allowed to update when everything is locked now? So this way you are not allowing non-repeatable reads. This, however, was possible in read committed, right? However, that is okay, that is a fix for repeatable reads. However, if I go and say, okay, but who is going to stop me to insert a record? No one. Nothing. Zero. Nil, as they like to call it. This is the phantom record in action. Now, once I select again, I will see that 200, the job candidate with ID 200. So if sound. So if that's a problem, take a look at something. If that is still a problem for us, take a look at how we are fixing this. Okay, guys, please. If we go and say that this is a problem, run against the 2012 instance. I am connected against the 2012 instance. So I place. Now I first want to show you the problem with serializable, back to the question from the audience. Take a look at this. I'm selecting some data. The first name that starts with B. Probably I'm searching for my name somewhere inside of this. So let's see. Now, here are the results, nothing special. However, I want to see what's going on. I want to try to insert myself, Mr. Boris Hristov, here. And what's going to happen? Blocked. Now, why am I blocked? That's very interesting. Why? Why am I blocked when, take a look, when exactly what we were discussing before a second, take a look at the locks. And let me show you something. Let me stop the insert because I want you to see carefully. Oops. I want you to see carefully what locks are we having right now. Why are we having and why are we holding just one shared lock on the whole table? Why is that the case in serializable when you are supposed to be running with the so-called key range locks to lock the whole range of values and not the whole table? That's completely different. Why? Because serializable is a bit problematic. It has to have supportive index for your queries in order to utilize those key range locks. So what this means is that if I roll back my select and I create an index on the where clause, on the column in the where clause, take a look at what changes. Create that. I'll run that again. Here it is. I'll open a transaction, actually. Here it is. And now let's first see the locks. Something changed quite dramatically. 900 locks, quite dramatical change. And take a look at the lock types. Ranges, etc., etc. Why? On all of the records and on the whole range, I locked the whole range of values by using the index structure, right? This is completely different from locking your whole table. And if I now try to insert a record, I'm again blocked, right? But I'm not blocked because I was locking the whole table. I'm blocked because the range of values is now locked. And so I cannot do anything. However, you can easily see how many locks you have now in your system. It's dramatic. It is dramatic. And because I want to show you the 3 a.m. example, imagine when they wake you up at 3 a.m. and they say, oh, there is a huge blocking scenario in our system. So these are the junior people who are going to wake you up during the night. And sometimes they don't know how to troubleshoot everything efficiently. And that's normal. And you wake up at 3 a.m. and you start to troubleshoot this stuff. And the last thing that you are going to think about, or at least I thought about, was what isolation levels are those sessions actually running under? And sometimes the answer can be here. That is why you really need SPWhois active. That is one of the reasons why you really need it. Because what I started to troubleshoot were indexes, stats, like, is something disabled? What's going on with the changes of this system? Were there any changes, patches, drivers, etc., what have you? The last thing that you are going to troubleshoot at 3 a.m. is, oh, let's see what isolation level are those sessions actually running under. And why are they running under serializable? Because they are using some really cool new technology, which is called entity framework with some other stuff that defaults to serializable in most cases. But they don't know about it. And sometimes they should not know, right? I mean, that's why we are a team. But bear in mind this stored procedure, especially with this parameter. This is a saver. I mean, this is a lifesaver and a night saver also. Now, last demo and we are going for a coffee, because I want to complete and end the pessimistic concurrency. And I hope that they are not going to leave after them, because there is more. So there is any one of you using partitioning in production? That may be. Okay. So just one person. You may want to see that demo, partitioning with log escalation. And I have prepared all of the various scenarios with creating the partitioning and everything. And I have played with all of the scenarios which you can have in terms of locking in partitioning with various sizes and stuff like this. You may want to see that just for completeness. Now, I want to skip that. And I want to show you those key range locks again. Those key range locks, this script is written by a guy that was here last time, Klaus from Austria. Sometimes when you see a script that's written in the best possible way, you don't have to rewrite it. You just have to give credit to that person. And Klaus written a really nice example about key range locks. Let me show you what it means. Creating a database, and this is the last one. Creating a database, and I create a table with two tables, parent and child. And there is going to be a foreign key between them, with onDelete cascade specified. Now, if I insert some records here and commit them, of course, nothing special about the records themselves. Now, if I run, and this is read committed. Okay, this is read committed isolation level. If I run and I start a transaction where I want to delete a record because it's on with cascade, it will go immediately and remove everything from the child table. Take a look at what happens though. Take a look at the logs that we are taking. Really interesting to see those type of logs in read committed. Take a look. Again, those guys. Range exclusive. Again, those key range locks. Why are we taking those key range locks then? Why are we taking them on the child table? Why? Because we have to be sure that while this delete is running, no one else will insert a new record in that child table, right? It doesn't work this way. So this is the mechanism that SQL Server actually uses to guarantee that no one else, in the meantime, will actually insert a new record in that child table that we are now about to remove. So if you see range X or range locks in read committed isolation level, that may be one of the reasons why are you seeing it. This is one of the reasons why you may see that one. Now, let's do a short break. Let's grab a cup of coffee. Please don't run. I hope it's interesting. I have more interesting stuff to come. And let's go back after 15 minutes, right? And let's move on. We have, let's say 30 more minutes, not more. It's okay? Okay, cool. Let's go.